Okay, so I'm going to introduce our panel. Welcome to session 8 of Tackling Insurgent Ideologies, the third edition of an annual conference we do on de-radicalization, violent extremism, ways to combat it, the information wars that we find ourselves in the midst of very often. The subject of this conversation is finding new narratives to counter violent extremism and radicalization through entertainment. Can cinema, can theater be an agent of positive change, or is it really incumbent on the entertainment industry to take on the role of a social actor in some way or the other? And I think we have a fantastic panel of people to talk about this. We have film director Vishal Bhardwaj with us. We have film editor Deepa Bhatia, who's joining us from Mumbai. Vishal, I believe you're in Missouri, so we hope that your internet stays connected right through. And we have Bani Tripathi, an actor and a member of the Central Board of Film Certification, and my dear friend and colleague Abhinandan Sekri from News Laundry, who's here to moderate this fascinating conversation with his wit and candor that we know him for. So Abhinandan, I'm going to hand over to you and let you take it from here.
All right, thank you so much, Maya. Thank you all for finding the time. I'd just like to start this off with an example of the kind of cinema that when I was young, a growing boy, that one watched. And I guess that was also a response to the entire call to bring the country together, which had been through a lot of turmoil. I'm talking about a film like, for example, Amar Akbar Anthony. And in that, Sab-Bishad Gai, one was raised as Amar, one was raised as Akbar, one was raised as Anthony. Or anyway, Sab Vapas Aaye and their father needed blood. You know, the blood is leaving their bodies and entering their father's body in the hospital. So Nehru's scientific temper may have been compromised, but it was compromised for something that was not as scientific but important, like secularism. So those are the narratives that I remember, Suraj Ek, Chanda Ek, Mile Sur Mera Tumhara. That was the kind of stuff we saw then. In today's digital age, where we see the kind of content, whether it is used by, radical outfits, whether it's the ISIS or the most hateful videos we see, which is impacting people, this kind of messaging, I guess today, is more important than it's ever been. But I don't see it today when it's required more than I guess when it was back then. So let me start with Deepa. Deepa, what is the kind of, are we even doing this in entertainment? Is this a conscious decision that people in entertainment are taking, or are we just going with jo dikhta hai wo dikhta hai?
No, I think, see, more and more cinema has become a tool for profit. So first and foremost, it is like what sells is what gets made more and more. I'm not saying exclusively. And then what sells is what sinks in with the dominant thought. So for example, currently you see a lot of films which are about nationalism, about patriotism, like you see, but you don't see films so much in the mainstream. Like we tried with, I was part of My Name is Khan, which tried to tackle an issue of, what went on in, for a Muslim community post 9/11. So by and large, such subjects were getting tackled. But
which you worked on as well.
Sorry?
Kai Poche also.
Yes, Kai Poche was, yes. It was in that sense a more sort of a more authentic attempt at, while My Name is Khan is with the mainstream idiom and, all of that. But I think, I'm looking at the kind of scripts I've read that come to me as an editor, and I don't see so much of that kind of content. Hopefully with the OTT platforms, we see now some kind of shuffling and some kind of, but yes, I'm just trying to think of what I've got to read and not so much in the space that you're talking about,
but why is that, Vishalji? Is the OTT platforms, is the economics different? Kyunki wahan par bhi the logic should be the same na, jo dikhta hai wohi bikta hai. The kind of narratives we that entertainment can actually influence, why is Deepa not getting the kind of scripts that she thinks would do this?
I think OTT, you're asking about the OTT platforms, no? OTT platforms ki jo audience hai wo bhi alag hai, it's different from the people who go to the theater. Jo penetration theaters ka tha, ab pata nahi ab aage kya hone wala hai, but jo unka penetration tha OTT ka, it's a totally different audience and a little evolved audience, and so that's why I think OTT is able to do what the cinema I hope the censorship is not brought on OTT ever, and I hope you don't have to give NOC to many ministries again and again. So I mean, there's so much pressure on a filmmaker now. Actually, I think in the kind of cinema we are making, Abhinandan, like she said, My Name Is Khan. I think Mulk was there. Before that, even Chak De, you know, the Muslim protagonist, you know, trying to prove himself that, you know, he's a patriot. That goal khaliya usne to, you know, he was. So, people have been doing this. And but even now, I think the OTT platforms are also a little apprehensive. You know, when you, they are also being very cautious.
I see. Vani, could you weigh in on the same thing, and then if you could also just move into OTT platforms and cinema aside, is this cinema, is our content consumption on tablets and thus such devices changing how we consume it as opposed to a experience, a collective experience, you know, vis-a-vis an individual experience? Does that change how we think, how we react? How does that impact content? But first, could you just talk about what is the stuff being made today? Is it relevant to our society?
I think I've written about this extensively, and I call the OTT platforms democratization of content in India. You see, the plethora of new narratives which are emerging today, independent filmmakers, and Vishalji would know this, a stream of youngsters who work with him today are making web series and are also writing stories for web series. Let's remember that the craft of filmmaking does not just belong to a director or an actor. It belongs to somebody like Deepa, who's editing that content. It belongs to the writers who are writing that story. Today, the democratization of content is also the writer rooms which have emerged. There's no one single Salim Javed Jodi which is writing Amar Akbar Anthony or Diwar. It's a shared collaboration. It's a space which is creating tremendous creative collaborations between somebody who writes a story. There are many more book acquisitions happening, and a whole team of writers gets together and that content gets created. Let's also remember, we are a very young country, Abhinandan. More than 67% of the population of India is under 32. What you saw in the last national election from then to now, and I have to take the election figure because the voting age becomes some kind of a paradigm of, you know, where young India is. This content is now in the palm. It's not collective viewing only. What you saw as that big silver screen 35mm experience, of course, that magic will never go away. But today it's private, it's personal. I consume this content exactly the way I want to consume.
Does that change what we consume? Does it change how we react to it?
Because it becomes very personal. It becomes like intimate theater. You're talking to me, I'm talking to you. What is happening now? It's not just entertainment in cinema. So much of stuff is being uploaded.
Even in
youth,
I saw anchors singing today. Ram Lalla Bhajan.
News is also entertainment, isn't it? No, but having said that, the whole dynamism of telling stories has changed. The whole context of telling stories has changed. And I think that is the new normal, and it's exciting. There's so much more violence. There's so much more what was called cuss words. I mean, I sit on that unpopularly popular Central Board of Film Certification, which you all call Censor Board. I look at films today, the narratives are so contextual, they are real, they are new. Women are the centerpiece, they are protagonists today. The misnomer used to be, make a film with a star who's a woman, it won't get financed, it will not get produced, it will never see the light of the day. Today, you are not bound on that theatrical release only. That whole fraudulent, I'm sorry, I'm being blasé, the fraudulence of exhibition of cinema has gone out of the window. And these dystopian times, the COVID times, I think this is the best time to tell a story which is personal, which is real, which is about our lives. And if it deals with violence, this is also a narrative which is going to touch us harder than it ever has before.
Sure, but I had a couple of announcements. One is Vishal is in a low network zone, so hopefully, you know, I can't see him on the screen, but I guess he'll join us. We'll kind of roll with the grenades, as they say, and as and when he can join us, he'll probably come in depending on the bandwidth available to him wherever he is. And secondly, all the viewers watching this, you can actually ask questions. You know, there's this little chat box there. You can put your questions on the chat box and ask us. Deepa, to what Vani said, she belongs to the board for certification. That is just one of the barriers you have to cross before you get a release. If you make any 4G films, you have to get MOD clearance. A, is that even sensible or at all desirable if we are to call ourselves a liberal democracy where we tell stories, we tell narratives, counter narratives, you know, better stories, better ideas emerge. So if that is a new requirement, other than the others that you may be able to tell us about, how does that help or inhibit the function of entertainment to tell stories that can counter hate?
So, see, you know, I've always felt like when I've just, like I've been editing for over 20 years now, generally, and I just kind of think of all my experiences, almost like anytime we've made something that touched upon anything political, anything religious, we've always encountered protests on the ground, somebody is filing a court case somewhere, something is going on, there can be changes from the censor board, which may feel to the filmmaker fair, unfair, you know, it's always this pressure when those kind of subjects are touched upon, you know, so that's one thing. So, like, I've always felt if, you know, if cinema is to, you know, I was just thinking about the topic of this this discussion. And the thing is, if there is to be some kind of change, it's always when ground reality and popular content work in sync. You know, it is when these two things are able. So, yes, for filmmakers to be braver to make certain kinds of subjects, there needs to be an environment which is conducive to allow that to happen. That's one thing. There needs to be a certain amount of, like when we made, even when we were part of Kaipo Chain, you know, it tried to touch upon certain issues. I was like very skeptical. What is going to happen? Will this film, you know? So I feel like things like permissions, things like how many, you know, you can't take certain kinds of names. You name a community, you run into a problem. You name a person, you run into a problem. The permissions, the kind of support, if you're making a film about the army or the navy, then the kind of processes you need to go through. All this filter the content. They filter the content and its ability to say what it truly wants to say. For whatever ideology or whatever, you know, and that I think needs to kind of be addressed. It needs to change because, like, I can give you a small example, like not so related to the topic, but if you look at, say, something like the way Hindi cinema tackled people with differences, you know, wo pagal hai, wo mental hai, these kind of this loose terminology, you know, about people who are differently abled or with people with LGBTQ community jokes, all that has got, filmmakers have to restrain themselves today because there's a ground activism that is working in sync with the with filtering the film content. So that's a positive change when intervention on the ground kind of helps us to get our films to be more sensitive, more politically correct or whatever else, you know. But sometimes that very thing of intervention becomes a hindrance, and then filmmakers, like a very small example, I was in a one mainstream filmmaker office and they were contemplating remaking Ram Balram, you know, the old film Ram Balram, and then they were like, naam hi nahi rakh payenge, chhod do. So people are they're cautious, you know, and just in a very small way you start self-censoring what you're putting out because it's becoming harder. It might become hard for you to get your film. So all the political films that I've been even marginally a part of have faced some or the other kind of protest, you know, and then you're waiting, is it going to release, are there going to be changes? So these things, yes, they need to be sieved out. We need to be able to express in a more free sort of manner for
Vani, I'm going to come to you with specifics on that, but before that, Vishal, if you could just tell us about, you know, you've just commented on the amount of NOCs one has to get. Ab forge pe film banani hai to aapko for MOD se bhi clearance chahiye. Is this desirable? Is it sensible? What implications does it have to filmmakers? Then can India ever tell a story like Platoon? Can we ever tell a story where the ugliness of war is shown to our people, or will we always show pretty wars?
Yeah, because, you know, if you're going to take NOCs from MOD, then you cannot even criticize them also, you know. You cannot take any other point of view also. And more than that, leave that apart, you know, it becomes such a hassle for a filmmaker. Right now, you know, that smoking ka wo jo hai, I mean, it's embarrassing. Ki wahan pe scene chal raha hai, scene ke upar aapka smoking ka ticker chal raha hai. It's embarrassing for us as a country when we go to the International Film Festival. It's embarrassing. People laugh when that comes, and now the things have started coming. Even the alcohol is bad for health. And sometimes, you know, it comes, this animal was not harmed, this is animated animal, and we have not used the, I mean, what kind of, as everything bad is happening because of the films in this society. and nothing else is responsible for that. Only film and filmmakers, so curb them. Now this new NOC, I mean, if this goes on, then you have to go to next, the railway ministry come that the color of the train is not good, or the breakfast in the train has not been shown in the right way. And then come the transport minister, the ministry that will come, they will say, okay, the truck is not shown in the right manner, the truck driver has been, I mean, it will go on and on. Rather than that, I mean, few filmmakers who have made this mistake, I mean, penalize them, make those kind of rules. Involve film industry, talk to us filmmakers, make guidelines, SOP. So, you know, people that they don't make mistake, they're accountable for if they make mistake. But you just can't pass a thing that, like Animal Welfare Board. I mean, we have to take, even if, you know, by accident, you know, some animal passes in a frame, then they will ask, get the permission for that. And is it possible, I mean, the Animal Welfare Board, their rule is that you have to inform them in advance about your shoot. So they might send a representative. I must have shot for more than 1,000 days in all my film. Never, ever any representative has come from them. They ask for a vet, we call for a vet on... but how is it possible for a rep of the Animal Welfare Board? Because at one given day, at least 400, 500 shoots happen all over India.
Yeah. How many will there be?
It's not possible. And leave aside the TV series, they are not asked for Animal Welfare Board permission. I mean, everybody knew, we all paid the bribes to get our certificate on time. So, even if you have not done anything wrong, so bring one more NOC, bring one more an army of middlemen, pay them, and then get exploited and get harassed.
So, Vani, what's the logic of this? You have to get MOD permission if you're... First of all, what is the rule that if there is any reference to the army in my film, I have to get permission? Or if the film is about the army, what is a film about the army? Is a film where my character is an army officer? Can you just tell us what is the rule like this and what is the premise behind it?
So let me first segregate this argument into various panels. The no smoking statutory warning is the health ministry. Animal Welfare Board is the Ministry of Environment. And we get badgered for it, whereas the CBFC has nothing to do with it. We've been fighting for it. Vishalji knows this. How many delegations of film workers have been sent to these ministries? But remember that the Cinematographs Act of 1952 is a redundant, archaic act. You know, we in the Central Board of Film Certification, in a nuanced way, have to look at those guidelines and take things out. So the act itself is crying for amendment. I mean, we are bound by guidelines which are as archaic as 1952. So within the act, you know, obviously at that time, there used to be a lot of talk about communal violence, about national security, about defense forces. And I'm sticking my neck out and I'm saying this, the act requires an act of parliament, which is an amendment. And if that doesn't happen, my hands are tied because I am that quasi-judicial body which will look at cinema. But let me tell you, Abhinandan, there is a very important word in storytelling and cinema, which is called intent. And I think when I certify a film, I will tell you, it's my sixth year, I'm the junior most veteran in this body, I always look at the intention of the filmmaker. Without even understanding, I mean, the camera could be between the thighs of a girl, or that could be aesthetically done, you know, with, you know, some kind of lighting, because the storytelling demands it to be so. I think that intention is what tells, which makes stories brilliant or cheap. And I think that is the distinction you have to make when you're certifying films. As far as the MOD clause is concerned, it's a part of the act, and I'm saying that we do require a constitutional amendment for it. But let me also say, when I look at a film like Zero Dark Thirty, I'm told, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, the State Department was very much a part of, you know, abetting the narrative which actually helped the film. They threw open, you know, so much research which had happened, you know, which the film required. So maybe there is a certain amount of collaboration required, where if you get into things like national security, and if you get into something which has been armed forces, you know, connection to that. I think that research, also filmmakers should research on it, should reach out to the government and, you know, help that narrative happen. But I'm saying to broad stroke, everybody is black, and then say what is white and what is black will never be understood. They are binaries. We are a hypersensitive democracy. We do have lobbies which talk of animal rights, then human rights, then women rights, then child rights, then Dalit rights, then LGBTQ+. I mean, at the end of the day, if you have so many narratives which become this hyperbole of a democracy that we are, if there will not be people who will be sensitive to it, it will be another narrative. People who are oversensitive to it will be very cautious. So I think...
But
the intention part is very important.
But I, there are two things. Actually, Vani, I disagree with you on the intent, because I've seen a lot of, in fact, even Section 66A speculated on the intent of causing disharmony. I think the intent is purely subjective. Someone can say, I have written an essay with the intent of insulting a community. I can say my intent is to bring certain facts to light. So intent is not a theorem. So that will depend entirely on, so on that, I don't think one can actually certify on intent, because you're speculating, you're trying to get into the mind of the filmmaker, which is actually not possible. But what you said about Zero Dark 30, you're right, because Zero Dark 30, the subject required them to very accurately represent, I'll just come, you know, how they went in and, you know, got Osama. But that's a choice a filmmaker makes. If the filmmaker doesn't want to, you know...
But no, let me correct myself. When I actually talk about intention, I mostly talk about objectification of women. At least this board in the past 3 years, which is Vidya Balan, and got to me a lot of women who are actors. I mean, there's an overcorrection which is required. And I think we should absolutely not fall short of agreeing with that. But the intention part is also, it is dependent on the human mind, Abhinandan, whether we like it or not. Certification board, for example, in France and United States, in France, frontal nudity is not a problem. They have a problem with gangster films. In the United States, it's the opposite. It's the Coppola and the Scorsese bandwagon that they've been riding high on. Gangster films are not a problem. They have a problem with frontal nudity. So there is a cultural nuance to every country which certifies it. And I'm sorry, either do away with the board. If you will have people, they will have a mind. As long as we can do capacity building and we can do empowerment of the people who are certifying films, we've been trying to sensitize them. But it's not an easy process. There are 9 people who sit with me on that panel. Most people don't know how difficult this procedure is.
Also, and there's so many
speech.
And the number of
a big speech to make them understand that the filmmaker does not want to harm anybody. So please look at it from the eye of the creative content of the film. I mean, this is the first time I'm letting it out what all I have to do inside that hall.
Oh, I understand.
All I'm trying to say is, Abhinandan, it's a work in progress. We require these collaborations to happen. Filmmakers have to talk to the certification boards like they do all across the world. And as we will get more sensitized about it, I'm sure there'll be a better ecosystem for it.
Sure. Vishal, you want to say something?
No, I wanted to say Zero Dark 30 was, you know, practically produced by White House. It was a propaganda film. They were called, the filmmaker was, like it's in the interviews, she was called, she was given everything. It was practically produced by White House.
So similar to what the nation did, yeah, so, right.
Yeah, but, yeah, it was produced by White House. Like, you know, if we go to, my script has been rejected twice by MOD, because here it's very difficult to get the permission from MOD to shoot and to get their help, because they see it from their, like I was making a film where a Pakistani soldier and an Indian soldier are trapped together in a no man's land. So it was a human story of those two soldiers. It was before that film which came and got the Oscar. No Man's Land.
No Man's Land.
Yeah, but I got a letter from MOD that you are showing, you know, an enemy country in a, showing them as human. Aren't they human? I mean, I have the right in democracy to tell a story the way I want it. So I mean, if you'll, then it's impossible. I don't know why I have they woken up it now. In major, I mean, the research, Bachchan Saab did a film called Major Saab. He had a beard in that film. He was not even a Sardar.
Hmm.
This is the one, but then at that point, you know, so the filmmakers who are making mistake and the big star like Bachchan Saab is making a mistake so many years back. So people who are making mistakes, they are not doing their proper research. They should become accountable to people.
Again, I think that can be criticized as a film that's done poor research, you know, just like the number plates. And I think it was J.P. Datta's film where the way the army numbers its number plates, it's not the regular number plates, it reflects the year, and that year didn't match with when the war was. I mean, these kind of things happen, but I think a filmmaker has a right to make those mistakes. Deepa, you know, you mentioned about the wokeness being, you know, sensitive to gender issues. Now, while that's all very, you know, desirable and good, but a film like a Kabir Singh, or the, it was a remake of, you know, another film, and this question from actually Ratandeep, this question is from, it is about this kind of cinema only. It's from Dr. P. Sri Kumar. It says, Malayalam cinema for the last decade is constructing a type of masculinity which is radical. Mm. Are the same trends observed across India? Recently, it was found that in Kerala, many of these films are funded by... Okay, I don't know. I mean, you made a claim. Terrorist funding, yeah, toh kuch bhi. If you got this on WhatsApp, sorry. I do not endorse that. I think it's a... Unless you can provide who funded it, that's a rather silly thing to say. But the first half of that such films are getting box office ringing. So the wokeness is all very well, but the wokeness is a little parallel movement happening, while the mainstream is
I'm saying that's fine. I'm saying that is what everything has to coexist, because I cannot fight for my right of freedom of expression and deny you your right. So I'm saying you can, so long as that's what I feel is getting achieved marginally by the OTT platforms. Because see, earlier when you think of cinema, or I think of my own correlation with cinema, like what was it? You go in there, it was almost religious. It was this larger than life experience, and it had an impact. Like, why did Ziga Vertov back in 1924 say that the camera eye is the camera truth? Or why do films like Triumph of the Will still hold that kind of spectacular spell? It was because the way they were designed and the way they were consumed. Now what happens is the avenues of opinions and information and content are just democratized. So in that sense, the power of cinema to really, you know, so even these rules of censorship and all, they're not so, we don't need to worry so much, because cinema doesn't have the same hold. It's not so exclusive anymore. It's not so star dependent anymore. There are other platforms which allow freedom of expression. You can, you know, it's so difficult to make a film like, on a woman's subject. And now suddenly you can do it, and you can put it somewhere where it will exist. And it's somebody, so I'm saying that I won't go see Kabir Singh. It's not my kind of cinema. I do not like that kind of content, but somebody will see it. But so long as there's content that's providing a counter, for we want to make an informed opinion, you know, or even to have the ability to dismiss it as entertainment, I'm just saying to filter it. I'm okay with anything being made. I'm not in favor of any kind of censorship on content. You know, we should all have filmmakers should be empowered enough to express, and audiences should be empowered enough to judge and decide for themselves, you know.
So will this
just one thing on Kabir Singh. And don't lynch me for what I'm going to say. If I was certifying Kabir Singh, I wouldn't have allowed the film to happen. I'm sorry. In the era of the Me Too, this kind of misogyny, and I spoke my mind. Then everybody joined in, and they said, obviously, a lot of websites said a censor board member's view on Kabir Singh. I mean, it's zilch. This kind of garbage, we have to stop watching. It rang more than 200 crores on the box office. It's not just about being woke, Abhinandan. This is horrendous. I mean, this kind of misogyny, I mean, this kind of patriarchy, if we start celebrating at the box office, it's doomsday. It is nemesis-like situation for Indian cinema. And we have to overcorrect it. It may sound on the other extreme.
Even if this we have to cannot overcorrect. Happen.
And if we don't talk about it loud and hard enough, if we don't talk about it now, there's never going to be a point. It's going to be Arjun Reddy and a Kabir Singh and X, Y, Z. That is going to rule. And we are going to be sitting in, you know, webinars like this, and we are just going to keep talking about, you know, what kind of activism cinema requires.
One second. On the censorship issue, while clearly filmmakers have a problem with the parameters or the arbitrariness of censorship, depending on who is sitting at the table. Right now, you feel very strongly on gender issues. I completely agree with you on the quality of you know, Kabir Singh and what it does, although I haven't seen it, I've read enough about it. I'm still not sure I'll agree whether it should be prohibited from being made. But when, you know, we are saying that the digital platforms are existing outside that, will censorship of film certification become less relevant, or is this going to extend onto OTT platforms? And that's also one of the questions that come in from
that's a bit of an empirical debate. I mean, when the spool, Deepa would know what I'm talking about, the big film spool went out of the window and the chip was coming in, there was a lot of nervousness about, you know, what is going to happen to those filmmakers who are so used to using that kind of film cameras and, you know, editors and so on. And Vishalji knows this. But that also coexisted. So I think OTT has one kind of audience, and theatrical releases will continue. I mean, to call one medium redundant because another one is becoming popular, I mean, films may not release for the next whole year.
I'm not talking about medium, I'm talking about, one sec, you got to understand the question. I'm talking about the role of film certification for cinema and for OTT. So will we see that role becoming limited to film and being redundant as far as OTT is concerned?
No, there is no regulation on OTT, so there is no debate here.
So are we
absolutely, there's no regulation on OTT. CBFC only certifies films for theatrical releases. So I mean, if we were to compare the two, I mean, OTT is absolutely free and democratic and you know, out of the space of any kind of regulation, and CBFC is there, which only, again, films which are streamed or which are shown on TV are not a part of the CBFC certification either. So, and I mean, these, abhi to ye do kinare milte nahi. These are absolutely separate situations. But I do want to say the reflectiveness of this issue is connected to who's consuming this content. We should be asking ourselves, what is the kind of audience which is seeing OTT, and what is the kind of audience, even if a year later we go back to the theater to watch cinema? That is what we should be.
This question from Priyal Pandey, Vishalji, if you could just take that. Is it incumbent on cinema to only be positive, or can they show the process of how someone becomes violent extremist and portray the whole process of radicalization? Can cinema portray the ugly yet honest reality? Well, actually, you worked on Marches. I think that film did it beautifully, showing how someone gets radicalized.
Yeah, it was beautiful, and it's just in long back it was. Guldasa made this beautiful film. So, I think actually, मुझे तो लगता है कि cinema is the reflection of our society. So, what Vani is saying, I completely agree with her. I have not dared to see Kabir Singh because the kind of stories I heard about it, I thought, you know, I'll go mad if I see that film. But in the same breath, I am saying, we as society gave it 200 crores back. So there's something wrong with us as people. So,
Sorry, go ahead, Vishalji, you can complete that.
That's why I'm saying that radicalization, or how someone becomes an extremist, and extremism has so many faces. Now we see the lynchings which are happening. Isn't that extremism? What happened in JNU and Jamia, isn't that extremism? What happened in Delhi riots, isn't that extremism? So there's so, I mean, it's just a Muslim terrorist. का होता था कि एक जो मुस्लिम कम्युनिटी है, एक पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी से ही एक्सट्रीमिज्म हो रहा है. नाउ वी आर ऑल्सो शोइंग आवर फेसेस, दैट हाउ मेनी फेसेस वी कैन हैव ऑफ एक्सट्रीमिज्म.
In fact, the next
we must show the mirror to the cinema's job is not to rectify. Cinema's job is to show you your face, that what kind of person you are, what kind of society you live in, what kind of people are we.
So this question is from Archit Lohani. Deepa, if you could take that. Does the depiction of terrorists or extremism in cinema often get misconstrued due to the glorification or sensationalism of the story or ideology? Do we?
I don't know. See, again, I think it is. See, like, why are these subjects picked? In what way do you want to make them? You know, and again, really, I would like to, because we are talking about countering extremism with popular culture, what are the idioms? Then it really means, how does, like, for example, a film like Heather, is a very important film because it does what it does within the mainstream, within the idiom of the mainstream, which is why I was excited to be part of Kai Poche. When you're talking about radicalization or how it was, what was of interest, for example, in that film was what happened to Omi, what led him to that act of violence, and neither is that act of violence glorified nor is it sustained, because the moment the bullet is fired, there's regret in the character's behavior. So the thing is, these little things, why is he vulnerable to what propaganda he's being subjected to? Because he's a follower. So the psychology of the mind that often will turn to violence is also in a very subtle way examined in that film. So that is the intent of the filmmaker with which that subject is picked up, you know. So I just feel it is like, why are you making what you're making? You know, are you there to glorify certain things? Are you there to glorify violence? Is there, because violence, like sex sells in this country. Like, for example, Kabir Singh, besides everything else, is also a very violent character, violent on women. So the thing is, these things, filmmakers, commercial filmmakers have a beat that these kind of things work. You know, they know that. So they use that to, so that is entirely governed by profit or sometimes ideology. So I just feel like it is really, if a mainstream filmmaker, like the way a Heather looked at certain issues, it was done with a lot of refinement, a lot of intellectualism, and at the same time, it had stars, it had music, it had an idiom that allowed that film to make an impact. So I think this balance is in the filmmaker's mind, how he's striving to say the story. And I think that is the center of, you know, how the impact of that film is going to be.
Vani, this question, if you can take, this is from Richard. Karni Sena, in support of Rajput nationalism and its competition with Jats, protested against the release of film 3 years ago. I guess that's Padmavat.
Padmavat.
And there was assault. There was another assault against Video 18. I guess he's talking about Video. What's
Viacom 18.
Viacom 18.
Viacom.
Motion Pictures. Still, this does not happen often, but it does happen. Will this change? Do you see this changing? Because even the filmmakers kind of buckled under that pressure, right? Because they feel that institutions aren't robust enough to back them. Isn't that why the filmmakers back down?
No, I don't agree. I think Padmavat became a national calamity. I remember 6 months before the film release, I'd written a piece for one of the media houses saying that nobody has seen the film. We've not read the script. There is a Central Board of Film Certification. By law, by the Constitution of India, has the power to, you know, look at a film and decide. But you've already taken a decision on it 8 months before. It's still in the making and you've already decided. So whatever those Karni Sena and those guys, those fringe, let me tell you, distinguish between what is mainstream and what is fringe. And these fringe groups get popularity. This is their claim to fame. This is their sikki bazi. Put the sikka in the jukebox and the music would start playing. That's the kind of, you know, game they were playing. And they got thoroughly exposed in the process. Of course, we had so much heartburn at CBFC because of Padmavat. That's a very long story and will require several hours of, you know, dialogue between you all and probably the audience. But I'm saying this with responsibility. Padmavat became a learning experience even for CBFC. Because we really did not have a go-to. We did not have a reference point of something like this. But let me tell you, CBFC did not give a single modification or a cut to that film. The title change happened, but that's also the filmmaker's decision. He decided that it was based on Malik Mohammed Jaisi's epic love story in Avadhi called Padmavat, and he decided to call it that. But one thing was clear with the Padmavat episode. These fringe elements which operate on socio-political levels in the country, they cannot always get headway. Yes, they will create that violence for a bit and will create a law and order situation. But let me tell you, the audience in the country is absolutely mature.
But the filmmaker did buckle, Vani. The filmmaker did buckle. I mean, her midriff was covered in the dancing scene. So it's not like they remain fringe and they make the noise and they go away. They have a real world impact.
Abhinandan, when you put a panel of historians which belong to the period and which are independent of you, I mean, what more can the CBFC do? And if they take a call on what? So again, I'm saying it was a learning experience. It was a episode where, I mean, otherwise the film would have had 100 cuts. Did it have any of those?
No, but I'm not attacking the CBFC. I think each time I speak, I think you say, I'm asking why didn't the CBFC can't physically go stop the Karni Sena. I'm merely disagreeing with the limited point that what you call fringe elements, I'm not saying they're your responsibility. They do have a real world impact. So I think we may be just brushing it under the carpet saying they're fringe. They're not fringe.
No, they have real world impact. No. When I say that the film was national calamity, there is a very deep sense of responsibility in saying that. And Padmavat, as I'm saying, was a great learning experience for various people, including the filmmakers, you know, and the filmmaking fraternity. But I'm saying any episode like this, if it ever will reoccur, it will not even get the same amount of traction probably this one got. I think the country woke up and people understood what this kind of nonsense eventually means.
I hope you're right. There's a question from Pooja to Vishal. Do you think we can make another Haider in an overtly hypersensitive country of ours with rising censorship and backlash? Do you think artistic freedom and confidence still exists? Vishalji, what do you think? You're on mute, Vishalji. We can't hear you.
I'm saying that obviously I can't make Haider in this environment. And it's not about the censorship. You know, I think the people in the censor board who they come to watch the film and for the certification, you can still argue with them. But you can't argue with people like Karni Sena, you know, and the government doesn't say anything about it. You know, it's a law and order problem. You don't enforce you can't enforce your law also. You can't protect a filmmaker. He was slapped over there by the Karni Sena. How could they enter? I mean, could it have happened any minister or a senior minister was there? नहीं हो सकता था ना तो आप लॉ एनफोर्स होता है नहीं जिसका मन चाहते हैं वो लोग वो तो छोड़े अभी फिल्मों की तो बहुत दूर है कि पोस्टर जला दिया फिल्म उतार दी अपने स्टेट में फिल्म रिलीज नहीं होने दी ये तो बहुत दूर की बात है अभी ये जो लिंचिंग हुई है अभी गुड़गांव में जो हथौड़े से मार रहे हैं उसका वीडियो उतर रहा है पुलिस देख रही है तो कहां इस कंट्री में अब बन सकता है और ऐसे एनवायरमेंट नहीं था आई कुड मेक Haider एंड आई कुड रिलीज Haider
ओके I guess that's the previous regime. It was released in this regime, but I could, as a mahol nahi tha, ye mahol 2014 ke baad hua hai. Let's accept this fact. I don't deny it. Um, this question is from Frank. Uh, Deepa, if you can take this, what are your views on measuring the effectiveness of preventing violent extremism, um, counter-violent extremism, um, activities delivered through a movie or a theater or a play? Are there any measurable metrics or are you, I mean, can one get sort of a, can you not hear me, Deepa? Okay, hello, check. Is this, have I been muted? Or should I just, now, Deepa, can you hear me?
Yeah, thank you.
So the question from Frank is that what are your views on measuring the effectiveness of countering violent extremism or preventing violent extremism? Activities that are delivered through movie or a theater or a play, how do you measure whether it has been effective?
That's a tricky question. I think isn't that to do with the way you would assess the metric on, like, say, the way a Kabir Singh succeeds tells you what the dominant thought is. So when you see that kind of content being accepted and embraced, you know, by people watching it repeatedly, or you know, then I think that's an indicator that people are, you know, in sync with that ideology or with that dominant thought. Because I can't really think of a film that I can, you know, in terms of jisne aise issue ko tackle kiya ho, and we are looking at you know, it's a collective response to it within the in Hindi mainstream, you know. I mean, yes, there are, yeah, so I can't just see if I've got anything in my
There's this question from Ratandeep. Vani, if you can take this. With the increase in nationalism and the dominant narrative, can depiction of Kashmir and armed militancy be portrayed in this time as it was portrayed back in 2014?
I don't think so. That should be an issue. At the end of the day, I would also say that, you know, I don't know why Vishalji would say that, you know, he can't make a Haider today. I mean, Haider got 5 national awards within the same government and the same dispensation, you know, that gets spoken about in various narratives today. So I can't hypothetically answer this question, but I think, and I believe in this, and I've written about it, spoken about it, any filmmaker who wants to make a film whether it's on Kashmir, whether it's on national security, I'm sure will be aware of the various narratives attached to it. As long as he or she is fair to all the binaries that involve that narrative, I don't think so it should be a difficult situation at all.
Well, then that's actually that's a no then. I mean, you've given...
No, why?
Answer is no.
Why is it a no?
You're fair. Go ahead.
I lost you.
I said the answer is actually no. You said as long as the person is fair, that rider itself is a no.
No, not
who
fair.
Who decides whether the person is fair to all narratives? I mean, there can't be God's theorem, right?
No, why? Kashmir has so many narratives. Why would you only pick up one and only speak about it? And if you do, you're a filmmaker, do it. Then obviously, somebody was talking about the social impact of cinema. You will see what will happen. Somebody will protest about it. So if you are immune to that, do it. All I'm trying to say is, again, that's the word I use, intention, Abhinandan. When I look at Heather, I have no questions about the intention of a Vishal Bharadwaj. Let us not broad stroke this and make this into a conveyor belt situation. As a filmmaker, he has a body of work and a sense of responsibility to the story that he tells and the way he tells them. And you know how they are. I mean, come on, don't be so blind to the fact that there are people who want to provoke, who make strange kind of cinema, it comes out and it creates a debate. I mean, if you have the right to offend, there are people who have the right to feel offended.
Sure.
You can't be so undemocratic that you will only look at what you want to say and say, okay, I have the right to offend everybody.
Yes.
There are people who have the right to feel offended. Give them that democratic right
yes,
to
know. Vani, no one is stating that way. I think we need to kind of structure some things that I would assume would be, you know, givens. No one has the right to deny anybody the right to take offense. It is acting on that offense that we are talking about. Otherwise, nothing makes any sense. I mean, I'm not saying no one... One sec, let me finish. I'll let you finish. I think it's a no-brainer that anyone says that you cannot be offended. Arey, someone's face offends me, yeah? You can't take my right away from being... I'm acting on that offense and I'm saying you cannot say that because I'm offended. There's a distinction in the two. So, you saying that you can't be undemocratic. Who's being undemocratic? Who's saying you can't offend? But when you say that, as long as you're fair... Now, I don't know if you've read the book Operation Blue Star or Mark Tully's book on Amritsar. If you see the character of Bhindranwale that gets made, that's a movie willing to be that is waiting to be made. But during that regime, no one would have it because they say, oh, you're glorifying him because we see Bhindranwale as this person, not this village bumpkin from Damdami Taksal who went on and became what he became and he shook the government. So what I'm saying is that this fairness is as arbitrary a term as Section 66A that Mr. Kapil Sibal had thrust on us, that as long as you annoy someone, you can't say this. Arey, get annoyed, yeah? But you can't say, I can't
no,
say
no,
this.
I am not saying at all that the, what is the, what, I mean, you are preemptively thinking of what I am saying is fair. Kashmir has so many binaries. Kashmir is, I mean, I'm married to a Kashmiri. I would know something about Kashmir. I mean, there's so many binaries as far as Kashmir is concerned. All I'm trying to say is, when a Vishal Bharadwaj makes Heather, there is a narrative that needs to be understood. But if somebody makes a film on Kashmir and goes on to say, oh, this is a separatist dialogue, this is only about this, this is only about that. I mean, if you talk about violence, you cannot not talk about the precursor to the violence. You cannot say, oh, this is violent, this is about it. This is all that I'm going to say.
Okay, I have
also the positive effect of the violence and what the residual effect of it is, that also should be a part of it. That is all that I'm trying to say.
Okay, I have another question. Although I do believe, Vani, you can say whatever you want. I mean, no one is going to tell someone else what they can and cannot say. I think that's very fundamental to democracy. But this question is, Deepa's gone. I wish she could have taken this. Okay, Vishal, why do you take this? This is from... If we can make a film about Charles Sobhraj, can they make a film about a Burhan Vani? Do you think that would be possible?
I mean, why not? I mean, there are two different characters he's talking about. Why is he making, comparing Burhan Vani and...
I think what he's trying to say is that Charles Sobhraj was an acknowledged villain. and a film isn't made on it, which makes him look quite suave. Burhan Wani is an acknowledged terrorist. Could someone make a film on him on the lines like Charles Sobhra?
Why not? He's a human being. The films are made on human beings. It's discovering human beings. Why he became, what was the reason for him to take the arms? I mean, you can make the whole film about him, because nobody is born an extremist.
But how far back would you have to go, Wani, to make that film that this gentleman just asked a question about? If one had to make a film about Burhan Wani? Under what circumstances?
Obviously, I mean, how can you make a film about one incident? I'm saying the beginning and the middle and the end of a story is equally important. Okay. I lost you in the middle. I lost you in the middle, Abhinandan.
No, it was just that question. I was coming to you with the same question. But since you said that one would have to give the historical aspect, like, you know, Vishal said, of course, you can make the film. But since you said, as long as you give full context, how much context would have to be given if someone would make a film on Burhan Wani?
No, talk about marches, no? Marches dealt with militancy, and I don't think marches in any way, and Vishalji was a part of it, eulogized the idea of somebody turning into a militant. It had its reasons. And the film very beautifully portrayed, you know, what could have been the reason for the militancy that happened in Punjab. I mean, why do we not look at the history of cinema? We only look at the bad films. We look at those films which had that aesthetic quality. Why do we not look at that narrative which has been there and the film worked? So I'm saying, without a narrative, you will talk about separatism, you'll talk about militancy. Well, you can. It will evoke one kind of reaction. But if you will create a reason within the narrative of the film that you're trying to make, of what happened and why it happened, I'm sure nobody is going to have an issue with that, and one shouldn't.
Okay. Although,
that's my point of view.
Yeah, I do know of one senior journalist who actually now works at the ORF who thinks otherwise and thinks that Marches was actually kind of eulogizing terrorism in Punjab. But Deepa, if you could take this question.
I just feel like, you know, when you look at the films, like, you know, it is when we talk about violence, I mean, you know, terrorism, violence, extremism, I really think if you look at, say, a film like, say, Lives of Others, the 2006 Academy, award-winning film from Germany, which is about the spying of the on East Germans from the Stasi. And the character is a spy and is a prototype of a villain. But in fact, there's a very beautiful moment which when he hears, you know, the two artists that he's spying on, they're listening to a piece of Beethoven, and he just thinks that how can anybody who hears this music, how can he be bad, how can he not be moved, you know? So, and then there's a human transformation of that character. So I just feel like what we as filmmakers in the current times need to focus on or to look at is to be able to create compassion in each other. You know, I think what is now missing more than ever is this intolerance towards other communities, towards other people, other opinions. You see that on social media, there's such violent reactions to the most common conversations. And I think that where film or content can, you know, serve us all better is to kind of create compassion, you know. And I know this sounds like some popcorn thing, but I think, like, even like if you take a simple OTT show like Patal Lok, you know, where you have a character like a guy who's violent, out and out a killer, but then there's a moment of his affection for an animal that just changes us in some way. It humanizes him. It takes away the demon quality. And I think these kind of things filmmakers need to find ways to create, to create a more tolerant world, you know. Otherwise, we talk about hostilities and, you know, aggressions. Yeah.
We have time for just one more question. This is from Sanjeev Tripathi. It says, in a heterogeneous society like ours, where the gap between the two ends is huge, is it wise to make films which may be reflective of the thinking of one small segment but may adversely impact a not so evolved section of society and it hurts their feelings? So is it, the word used is is it wise to make a film? So let's talk about the wisdom of making such a film. Vishalji, why don't you go first? Is it wise to make such films that may hurt a large community, even though they're telling the story of a smaller community?
I mean, वाइज और अनवाइज की क्या बात है इसमें, इसमें फिल्म मेकर वांट्स टू टेल अ स्टोरी, ही शुड हैव द राइट, अदर दे डेमोक्रेसी खत्म कर दो ना यहाँ पे एकदम बिल्कुल, फेयर इज फाउल एंड फाउल इज फेयर, यू नो वी विल कम टू दैट थिंग. सो इट्स माय प्रेरोगेटिव द स्टोरी आई वांट टू टेल. इट्स अ सर्टिफिकेशन बोर्ड इज देयर, इफ ही फील्स, इफ ही डजंट, इफ दे फील कि ये नहीं रिलीज होनी चाहिए फिल्म, इट्स गोइंग टू ऑफेंड सो मेनी पीपल एंड पूरा देश का पूरा स्ट्रक्चर चेंज होने वाला, फैब्रिक चेंज होने वाला है, दे वॉन्ट. हालांकि इतनी खूबसूरत बात है, देश में आज तक कोई फिल्म जो है सिर्फ गवर्नमेंट की फिल्म बैन हुई है. एनएफडीसी की 50 फिल्में बैन होगी कम से कम, 50 नहीं कम से कम ज्यादा मैं बोल रहा हूँ, 10-12 तो होगी होगी. जो फिल्में तो मैंने जिनका म्यूजिक किया जो बैन हुई है, गवर्नमेंट अपनी फिल्में बैन करती है, बाहर की कोई फिल्म बैन नहीं हुई यार. आप वो देखिए, वो सारी फिल्में जो है फाइनली कोर्ट से पास होती हैं. बैंडिट क्वीन पे भी हुआ था ना,
बैंडिट क्वीन,
बैंडिट क्वीन इज एग्जांपल. सो दैट वे हमारा डेमोक्रेसी को तब तक तो बहुत अच्छा था, अभी कोई केस आएगा तो पता चलेगा कि हमारी यू नो
देखते हैं.
हाँ बिल्कुल, तो बहुत अच्छे हमारा जुडिशियरी ने पूरा साथ दिया है, पूरा कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के साथ रही है जुडिशियरी. होप कि आगे भी हमारे साथ रहेगी जुडिशियरी, मतलब तो इसलिए वाइज एंड वाइज की कोई बात नहीं. आई, इट्स माय प्रेरोगेटिव एज एन इंडिविजुअल, इट्स इफ आई एम लिविंग इन डेमोक्रेसी देन आई हैव द राइट टू से व्हाट आई वांट टू से.
बट फॉर द यू नो फॉर द ऑडियंस, द क्वेश्चन वाज आस्क्ड बाय एन एक्स चीफ ऑफ रॉ बाय द वे. सो एनी क्लोजिंग थॉट्स वानी, वी हैव 2 मिनट्स लेफ्ट, सो इफ यू कुड यू नो गिव अस anything that you think is worth taking away from this discussion, and then Deepa, I could come to you.
Nietzsche very famously said, what doesn't kill you makes you okay. So within these COVID times, these dystopian times, if it is not going to kill us, it's going to make us stronger. I have a feeling there are very rich films coming, very rich content coming out when all this is over, if this is over soon. It's almost like a dystopian film with a we knew the beginning, we are in the middle, we don't know when it's going to end. But the democracy of a filmmaker will not get compromised in this country, Abhinandan. I'm saying this as a filmmaker, as an actor, as a producer. And also, we have no business to, you know, impinge upon other people's creative freedom. You have a story to tell, you should be allowed to tell it, period.
Deepa, what story are you telling next? Which one is the important one that we must now know of?
Nothing in the sphere of this discussion, making a biopic on Saina Nehwal, which is on a badminton player. So yes, a bit different ground. But no, I just concur with Vishal, with Vani, that look, it's really important that filmmakers be given that freedom to express themselves, and our society is sturdy, you know, capable to be able to reflect, react, and you know, decide where they stand in terms of you know, extremism, violence. These are things they're very capable of negotiating. But filmmakers should have the freedom to make what they can, and we should have the faith that they'll be doing it responsibly.
I have some free advice for you in that. Do a remix of Dhal Gaya Din. You kind of smashes in that song, so just saying. Vishal, what is the story you're telling us before we say goodbye to the audience? What is the most important story that needs to be told that you're going to tell us?
You know, I still have to, because we have to come out of it. I'm very so confused at what kind of film I want to make and I should be making, because we don't know if the story, you know, if you write or a script you write, whether that's going to be with mask or without mask. So whether you have to put it in period or the current time when this pandemic is going to then, you know, end. And I want to say one more thing, because Mr. Sanjeev Tripathi is ex-chief of RAW. I have met him, so I didn't connect. I want to say RAW is too secretive. They should give some stories to us what their operations are, how they operate, and let them. We should create something, because we have never made a good spy film. You know, the real spy film, because the RAW is so secretive. I mean, I have been after RAW for a very long time, so I know where their office is.
Well, better than the RAW being after you, so fine. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you, the team at ORF. Thank you, Maya. And thank you all, those of you who did join. Do continue watching the wonderful discussions that this series of Tackling Insurgent Ideologies brings to you. Have a great evening.